everyone. Welcome back to our live Facebook feed from here at this year's CRAs. My name is Katie LeBlanc. I'm a patient partner with the Arthritis Patient Advisory Board of Arthritis Research Canada. And today I'm here with the lovely Michelle Teo, who's a UBC Faculty of Medicine, Division of Rheumatology, Clinical Assistant Professor in Penticton, BC.
Instructor. I wish I could say I was a professor.
Okay.
I'll get there at some point.
But today she's going to tell us a little bit about herself and her research and her experience at this year's CRAs. So first, Michelle, can you just give us an idea, a little bit about your background and how you're involved in rheumatology in BC?
Absolutely. So thank you very much for asking me to come and to give this interview today. So I'm a rheumatologist. I've been out for about 5 years now, and I practice in beautiful Penticton, British Columbia. So that's in the interior of BC, also wine country. And it is, I'm sure many of you can imagine, underserviced area where there is a very large need for rheumatology access. When I was in training, I started developing an interest in models of care and trying to figure out more efficient and effective ways to see patients. But as I'm sure you could be aware of, you know, you just have to, you know, do what you need to do during training and pass your exams and then go out. But that was something that I really wanted to address. I didn't think I was going to do it as quickly, though. I thought I would get some experience under my belt. It takes a little bit of time to learn what rheumatology is. Let me tell you, real life is not what the Royal College tests us on. And then maybe after about 10 years of practicing in the traditional model, then gain some experience. But when my husband and I moved to Penticton, I realized the incredible existing need. And I was in a position where I couldn't see new consults. I could barely see the patients that were transferred to me from the existing rheumatologist, that I realized that we needed to start learning and developing more efficient models of care. Mm-hmm. So that's what I started off 5 years ago with, at that time, one nurse. Now we've expanded to the point of 3.5 nurses and 2 MOAs. And we've been able to double the number of patients that we see from, if I was by myself, 2,300 patient visits per year. I've got young kids at home, right? So they take a lot of time as well. And no new consults, to the existing model where we see 360 new patients a year and 4,400 patient visits a year in total. So it's really dramatically transformed what we've done there. And my next step really is, well, to constantly evolve that model and to and continually improve on it. As you know, rheumatology, we're not a stagnant type of operation. Unlike family physicians who say you only can look after this number of patients safely, we continue to take care of our patients for the long term and are still expected to see new patients. So that constantly needs to, that model constantly needs to be looked at. But my next big goal is to teach others who are working in underserviced areas and mentor them so that they too can establish and implement a similar type of practice.
Interesting. So what does this model of care look like for a patient who's newly diagnosed to come and see you? How does the nurse help streamline that process?
Absolutely.
And allow you to see more patients?
Absolutely. So the key to this type of model is absolutely teamwork and trust, right? Mm-hmm. And there needs to be the ability for the rheumatologist to delegate. And in working in underserviced areas, my opinion is that a rheumatologist needs to reserve his or her energy for the three things that we are absolutely irreplaceable for, which is diagnose, treat, and problem solve. The rest of it needs to be delegated to well-trained and trusted team members, right? Mm-hmm. And how the clinic flows is that my nurses will see every single patient. The patient's got to do a little bit of work too. So they actually, while in the waiting room, they fill out something on a touch screen that provides us outcome measures such as HACCS and PASDAIS and, you know, DAS28s, all the information we need for that. They also let us know through this touch screen process if they've been to hospital, if their medications are changed or what have you, so that even before the patient comes into the examination room, my nurse knows what their outcome, how the trends of their outcome measures have changed, what their labs are, what their biologic test is. All my patients on biologics get a test to ensure that they know how to use them safely. And from there, and notice how long the morning stiffness is. And so then my nurse is able to dive into where any of the concerning features of their answers are, dive into that, and then I come in after the history and joint assessment has been done, and then I see a joint assessment there on our screen with tender and swollen joint counts. I see those labs, I see the results of what they did and while they're in the waiting room. I hear what my nurse has to say, and you know, within a minute or two, we pretty much have a good plan, and we can reserve the rest of the time for the appointment, talking about do we continue on with what we're doing, or do we need to change things. Mm-hmm. My nurses also help me with returning patient phone calls. That's the only way we can really do it in a timely fashion. Mm-hmm. So all the patient frontline work, my nurses take care of, and if there are things that are not comfortable for them to deal with, or they feel is out of their scope, or very concerning, then that most certainly is brought to my attention. The beauty of this, though, and I do say a lot about nursing, in BC, as most of your audience is probably aware of, we have really started growing this BC rheumatology nursing community because of how we can build certain patient visits. But this type of model is most certainly spreadable to any other type of jurisdiction that does not have access to nurses. So most certainly ACPAC, or very well-trained physiotherapists and occupational therapists, can also fulfill this role. And furthermore, this model is sustainable and even profitable for the rheumatologist without the nurse billing code that we have in BC. So it most certainly can be applied across the country to any underserviced community.
Wow, that sounds really interesting. So can you tell us a bit more about how you think arthritis models of care will advance in the near future?
Mm-hmm. So, I think we can't lump it all under just rheumatology patients, right? Mm-hmm. Because there are very different issues that rheumatologists face in over-serviced areas, right, and more urban centers than the patients that the under-serviced areas see. So I have to be honest, I really cannot speak to the larger urban centers, right? What I see is that there is a large, huge need for our rheumatology patients in rural centers, and I personally do not feel that they should be receiving substandard care because we cannot think outside the box. We've talked a lot, conference, we've talked a lot about the bottleneck that exists, and I think to the point that we are at right now, all rheumatologists do the best job that they can, absolutely, for their patients. I do not think a single one of us does not want the best for a patient, but the problem is that we don't understand how much of a role we play in this bottleneck in the underserviced areas. The system has a part to play, absolutely, but by changing how we practice while still maintaining that standard of care, right, we absolutely can open that bottleneck a little more and provide access for our patients who right now drive 8 hours or stay overnight over multiple mountain passes to have a quick 10 or 15 minute appointment with us. I really don't think that's fair. Our rural patients need to do that. And nor do I think it's fair, though, that our colleagues who are willing to go to the front lines, to go into the trenches where there is this enormous need, are not supported and don't receive the mentorship to be able to establish a model that will make their work environment, positive, not only for patients, but for the rheumatologist him or herself. When you work in a model of care, especially when you're involving other people, and it's a team that you trust, there's a lot of positivity, everyone's on the same wavelength, it's a wonderful environment to work in, right? And we support each other. So I think it can be absolutely win-win, but we just need to do a better job in supporting our colleagues in underserviced areas to think about this.
Yeah, so it sounds like it's heading more towards an interdisciplinary approach. And do you find that the patient voice has been important in moving towards this model of care?
Absolutely. We have so many patients that say, wow, I cannot believe the comprehensive care I just received. Keeping in mind that I'm probably spending less time with them than most of my colleagues would if they didn't have this type of model. But they are receiving care from the room, from myself, but they're also getting that time with an allied health professional, which in our case is a nurse. And I took over a practice, 39 years old practice, and I have not had a single patient have concerns about our existing model. And we have people that come far and wide just for that model because of what the positive comments they've heard from their friends.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Interesting. So I want to talk a little bit about the name of your presentation here at the CRAs, and what are some of the key takeaway messages you want our audience to learn from?
Absolutely. So since 2011, there has not been a community rheumatologist that has been successful in a CRA grant application. And this year, myself as well as Dr. Barry Kaler were successful. And it was highlighted, right? What is going on? There's a disconnect between our academic rheumatologists and our community rheumatologists. So I was asked to co-present the workshop, which is called, the CRA application, all things that you were scared to, or too afraid to ask.
Could you just outline what that grant is called for our audience?
CRA?
Yeah.
Or the CRA grant?
What is that for? Yeah.
The Canadian Initiative for Outcomes in Rheumatology.
Okay, thanks, because some of our audience may not be aware.
I beg your pardon. So the CRA, The CRA grant is a lump sum of money that is put aside to advance rheumatology care and is awarded to CRA members, so Canadian Rheumatology Association members. Generally, rheumatologists needs to be a co-investigator with these initiatives. And there are three pillars that are available. So access is a big one. Interdisciplinary models of care is another. And the third one has education and awareness. I think the big concern there have been, so you and I both know, we have incredible talent in Canada, and we have tremendous researchers, rheumatology researchers, that do phenomenal work. Right? Mm-hmm. And many of these people have been successful in acquiring CRA grants, which is phenomenal. We most certainly want to continue to advance the careers of our rheumatology colleagues at academic centers. But it's unfortunately given the perception that that is what this grant is for. And initially, when this grant was made, it was hoped that this grant would be used to allow community or allow small projects within the community setting that could be spread to other areas, right? Something that the frontline rheumatologists could use to help advance the care of their patients. And there were just these small little grants, small amounts that were asked for. And now, many large value grants have been awarded, right, to academic amazing researchers. And I think that scared off a lot of community people. With that being said, I'll be honest with you, I don't know the first thing about applying for a research grant. And I think unless a community rheumatologist has a lot of time on his or her hands and has done them before, it's unlikely that they have either. So the tips and what the take-home point that I really wanted to emphasize during my talk was that the community rheumatologist, A, absolutely has access to these funds. It does not need to be a very large project. And thirdly, you need to collaborate with an academic who knows this stuff inside and out. Community rheumatologist sees the big picture, knows what project needs to take place, and helps acquire that data through that, the actual seeing of the patients. But together, through this very win-win situation, right? I think a CRA grant application can be successful and the project very fruitful.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us today about this. And it's really interesting to hear another perspective on a model of care in rheumatology in BC that can help to streamline the process and to see where the future is in that avenue. So thanks so much again. And do we have any questions from the audience?
Just a quick general question. Someone has a question about how to manage pain, and especially in a more rural community where access to care is not as accessible.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I guess the question is the nature of the pain that person is experiencing, right? So are we aware if it's inflammatory arthritis, right? As we all know, there's two types of pain out there, right? There's pain due to wear and tear arthritis or injury, overuse, trauma, and then there's the pain in the joints that's associated with an overactive immune system. Rheumatologists in underserviced areas, pretty much this is all we see, right? The overactive immune system related pain. We don't see a whole lot of the wear and tear arthritis pain, and that is a challenge in itself, right? There's a lot of work that can be done there. But you know, furthermore, the options available to treat wear and tear arthritis can be very varied, and it most certainly depends on the patient. Starting off with over-the-counter type of products like acetaminophen is generally the place to start, and working with your family doctor to assess to see is it safe to continue, and are there any other options that can be escalated, such as anti-inflammatories or other type of medicines that can be considered depending on the nature of the pain. It's very challenging. It's very, very challenging to manage pain, right? Especially when one in four Canadians have arthritis, and before we know it, in 10 years' time, one in three people will have it, and most of that is going to be the wear and tear arthritis. So, increasing awareness of what the pain is, and working with your family doctor initially to understand does it require the assessment of a rheumatologist will be key.
And are there any incentive that will help aspiring rheumatologists to work in interior BC instead of just staying local?
Absolutely. I love that. So right now, there is no incentive for people to leave the big city where they have their family, where they have their supports, where they have their colleagues, their familiarity. Why on earth would they want to go to an underserviced area where they may be the only person there, they don't have any support from their colleagues, mentorship, and especially in developing a model of care to try to make that more efficient? That takes a lot of time, energy, and money, right? But funny you should ask this, we have just started a program called the Arthritis Access Program in collaboration with the Arthritis Society of BC at UConn. And we are mentoring our new grad up in Prince George over a 2-year period. We will be collecting data. We have Dr. Deanne Mackay involved with ARC to be our lead researcher there. And the goal is that we will eventually have outcome measures where we can go to payers and say, this is why you need to continue this type of project. And the beauty of it is, as we were saying earlier, it is not specific to nurses. It can be used with any other type of well-trained, rheumatology allied health member. So there is work going on. It's going to take a few years, though. Just give us a few years. But it's already started.
Plus, wine country is gorgeous.
Oh, absolutely. Yep.
All right, so thanks so much, Michelle, for taking some time out of the busy CRAs to talk to us today. We really appreciate it.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.